what? Is a what?
Bad witness.
It's hard to tell people to be disciplined in Bible study, prayer life, and giving, and look at us, we all dying from diabetes.
Right.
We're all dying, but we have lack of control. I'm just saying. It really shows that we really make a bad witness.
Right.
Okay? So, next reason. Bad health is very what? Costly. You know it will cost you, if you get to the ER right now and told me you have a chest pain, just for me to rule out heart attack. I ain't about to say you have a heart attack, just rule out heart attack. When I get done with you, your bill will be $21,000 to $25,000.
Woo!
From the lab work, x-rays, put you on a stress test, and you gotta pay the cardiologist to read the EKG, you gotta pay the cardiologist to read the stress test, and you gotta pay the ER doctor for what we do. The pathologist gotta read your x-rays, radiologist, your pathologist for your blood work. When we get done with you, it's almost $20,000 to $25,000. Now, if so happens you have a heart attack,
$50,000.
And you go in for a cath procedure or something. You look up to $50,000, $70,000, $100,000. So if you have a heart attack, you gonna have one. Sometimes you will. So it costs, y'all. Y'all know it's costly. You know what I'm talking about? Your health is costly. And people come in today's time, it's getting worse, y'all. It's getting worse. Insurance don't pay like they used to pay.
That's right.
We have abused, the doctors have abused the system. The patients have abused the system, and now there's no system on it.
That's true.
So it costs a lot of money. And you know, it'll take but one big hospital to build them to make you broke. That's your life.
That's it.
People come out of the hospital with $200,000, $300,000 bills, and they're broke for the rest of the day. They go home and have to go in foreclosure and you know what I'm saying, go bankrupt because they can't afford the bill. Also, our family deserves better. You know, as you get older, you should be thinking about this. You want to live a life where when you get 80 and 90 years old, that you can take care of yourself. You don't want to be caught where somebody got to take care of you. You should love your family more than that, you know?
Right.
I think that every day when I go to work, and I see people come in who are 60 years old, 50 years old, who have massive strokes, and they can't even walk. They can't even wipe themselves.
Oh,
and can you imagine what their family, I mean, y'all, some of you probably take care of some of your family members. Mm-hmm. It's a burden sometimes.
Yep.
You love them, you want to take care of them. So if just for your family, try to be the best you can in your health. So as you're older, you won't be a burden on the people who love you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay?
That's good.
Being out of shape also might indicate idolatry. Why did I say that? Well, if we can't push the food away, sure, take care of our bodies, then we may ask ourselves, what other gods do we have?
Right.
That's good.
They could become, some people have become a god. I had a young man weigh up 800 pounds or so 2 weeks ago. And I felt, and then you start his lifestyle, you talk to him, you know, he became depressed,
wow.
He lost his mother, his wife, I mean, he was like, he was 200 pounds then. And he had a problem with marriage and his family.
Mm-hmm.
And so it got to the point to start eating. And that became his comfort zone.
Yes.
And you look around, he was 400 pounds.
Yes.
Nobody ever been. If you know him, he was 600 pounds. Now he's almost 800 pounds.
Jesus.
You know? I'm sitting there ministering to him in the ER, just praying with him, ministering to him.
Yeah.
He was like, man, I wish you were around. I wish you could talk to me 400 pounds ago.
Right.
You know, but he was depressed. You never know people's story until you talk to them.
Right.
You can judge them all day long. But when I heard his story, I'm like, oh my God, he needed a savior.
That's right.
He needed a savior, and he found, and the fool was his savior. And it made it worse.
Ooh, right. Jesus.
I tell people all the time in ministry, everybody is looking for a savior.
Amen.
Our job is to present our savior to be better than what they're looking for.
That's right.
Some people, drugs have become their savior.
Right.
Sex have become their savior.
Right.
Alcohol become their savior.
Mm-hmm.
And our job is to present Jesus.
Right.
Say, I follow better savior than what you got.
Come on.
Now, everybody wants a savior.
Amen.
Everybody. And better health means what? More energy to do what? God's work.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Proper care requires rest. And it's biblical to get rest. God expects us to take time off to focus on him and enjoy his blessings. And even for some of us are called to the mission field. It's hard to go on mission work. You all, you know, you out of shape, you can't walk. Mission's a lot of walk. Mission's a lot of walk, right? We go to Africa, we go to the Dominican Republic, we gotta walk for miles. It's hard to get around, you like, I'll just take the ride, I can't way up for me.
Jesus.
You gotta find you better dish somewhere else. I mean, it's a great calling, you know? So, to even do the mission. And then also what? Our body is what? The temple of the what?
The Holy Ghost.
Created us and dwells in us and expects us to be wise through the body he gave us. What does poor physical and spiritual health do? Well, it can account for the breakdown of our physical bodies and our spiritual lives. We find our hearts no longer beat passionate for God or his purpose. Instead, we substitute formalism for faith and empty rituals for the life of the Spirit.
Ooh, Jesus.
And by going through these religious motions, we plug ourselves into an artificial life support system. We are not alive, but only existing. My God, I see this so often, y'all. I pray for the church. I see so many people in the church who are only existing. They're not alive. But we as believers need to identify those thoughts, those behaviors in our life that jeopardize our spiritual core. I don't have time to point finger at what you put on your life. I need to work on myself. That's why I tell the Lord, help me. But if it costs me just to exist, I'm in trouble.
Right.
I don't want to be on our artificial life support when it comes to religion.
Man.
When it comes to spirituality. I want to be alive. And so often we come to our churches and we go to the formats. We go to the formats of worship. You know what I'm saying? We go to the formats of praise and get up and lift your hands.
Talk about it, sir.
Then you lift, you stand up. And we go to the formats of faith and become empty in our life.
That's right.
Spiritual life. Mm-hmm. Now I say, Lord, I don't want to be like this. I pray all the time, Lord, let my worship be for real.
Yes.
Let my life be for
Amen.
Real.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So, in my last slide here, life is God's gift to us, okay, to you. But what you do with your life is your gift to God.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. Once again, life is what? God's gift to you. But what you do with your life is your gift to God. Yes, we should exercise. Yes, we should take care of our health. However, in the pursuit of all these things, we must not lose the sight of God. The reason we care for our body is not to prolong our own lives or gain for popularity, but it is because we value and desire to be stewards of God's gift to us.
Mm-hmm.
You should have a desire to have a good life.
Amen.
You should have a desire to live a kingdom life.
Mm-hmm.
So you can help others.
Jesus.
Also enjoy kingdom life. You should not want to just have a good life or to live long because you want to just for you to be healthy. Okay?
Exactly.
But you should also want to be healthy for a purpose. A balanced health in God. 3 John said, beloved, what? I pray that you may what? Prosper and what? All. These are words in my Bible. I circle a lot of things in my Bible. And I circle the word all. You may prosper in all things and be in what? Health, just as your what?
Soul.
Prosper. this is a good life right here.
Yes, it is.
Prosper in all things. And Bishop Parker asked myself one time, I said, what is prosperity? Is it just having a lot of money? God said, no. Not that. A lot of people have a lot of money, but not prosperous. And it took me to second Corinthians, where Paul talks about giving. And he said that when you have enough, and God has met all your needs, and you have enough to help somebody else, that's a prosperous person to me.
Mm.
That's prosperity. When God has met all your needs, and you have enough to help somebody else, then I say you are a prosperous man, you're a prosperous woman. So it's more than just having all the money in the world.
That's right.
If you don't help nobody, you don't bring nobody up in life, you don't bring nobody to the kingdom, then you're not prosperous. Paul told Timothy in 1 Timothy 4 chapter 7 and 8, he said, train yourself to be what? Godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things. Hold a promise for